Hello and welcome to NewsClick. Today in Talking Science and Tech, we will be looking at the issue of different modes of transmission of the COVID-19 virus, that is the SARS-CoV-2 virus. Since the beginning of the pandemic, there has been debate about whether this virus is only transmissible through droplets, which can only travel up to 6 feet, or is airborne transmission also possible, that is through aerosols, which can travel longer distances. So just a couple of weeks back, the World Health Organization and the Center for Disease Control in the US did recognize that, in fact, airborne transmission is possible. So today we are joined by Praveer Purkayastha, who will be talking to us about this, about what led to this conclusion, why did it take a whole year since the beginning of the pandemic, and what implications will this have for the future for our indoor spaces, indoor infections, and the wearing of masks, etc. So Praveer, can you first tell us, you know, why it took a whole year for these major bodies, health bodies, the WHO, the CDC, to recognize that that airborne transmission is happening for COVID-19?
You know, this was quite well understood by the lay public as well, that airborne transmissions are happening. But why did the technical bodies like CDC and WHO take so long? And I think there was a huge amount of misunderstanding between those who study aerosols, airborne particles, as a matter of physics, and this is really something which engineers and physicists do study, and those who are doctors. And because they came from two different disciplines, it appears that their use of words might have been the same, but they really were not talking of the same phenomena or the same set of issues. So droplet in physics does not mean that it is of a certain size alone. It's really that it is something which has a size, and it can also float in the air. For how long it floats, that's a separate question. And that depends on not just its size, but depends on a number of other issues as well. So the droplets, and for the medical community, seem to mean that it's basically a liquid particle. Now, if you take this issue of how people see it, that clinical practitioners, doctors, the health community, they seem to believe that a particle less than five micron is not airborne for long periods, and it deposits quickly on the ground. Within 1 to 2 meters distance, a particle will fall rapidly to the ground if it is more than 5 microns in size. The reality is that it can be airborne for quite some time, and it depends on a number of other issues. Partly also, is there a certain air current in the place? And even if you're sitting inside a room, there are air currents which are there. And typically, the 5 micron particle, about 5 to 8 micron, 5 to 10 micron, does not fall to the ground within 1 to 2 meters of the source. It in fact can travel some distance depending on other conditions, and it can also stay afloat for about 10 minutes, at least 10 minutes. And under some conditions, a 5 micron particle can stay in the air for an hour. And if there is a current of air, it can even stay longer. So this whole understanding that 5 micron is the critical size above which a particle falls to the ground rapidly was something which the medical community seemed to hold, but it wasn't something which the aerosol community, and I mean physicists and engineers, were in agreement with. But unfortunately, in this particular case, the decisions were being made by the health community. So though they were speaking the same words, they did not mean the same thing. So this is one communication gap which existed in the two communities. When we look at the genesis of this issue, it seems that most of the research which the medical community had accepted as de facto size related was not related to size. It was really related to tuberculosis infection. And tuberculosis infection is a particular case where the particle has to penetrate, this particle has to penetrate deep into the lung. And because of that, if it is less than 5 micron, it does penetrate. If it's larger than 5 micron, it doesn't reach that part of the lung, which the TB particles actually infect the patient. So given that 5 micron was not something which was the property of the aerosol, but the specific issue of tuberculosis infection. But unfortunately for the medical community, they sort of identified the 5 micron is something below which it's a drop, above which it's a droplet, above which it will fall to the ground in a very short distance, and therefore it's a droplet and not an aerosol. While to the community of physicists and engineers, this was not true. And they knew from their own studies that this could aerosols could be larger than 5 microns, droplets come in a number of sizes, and it does stay airborne, and it does travel much longer distances than 1 to 2 meters, which was thought to be the critical issue. So therefore, for most of the WHO CDC experts, they believed that it is a droplet falling on surfaces, which is the main reason for the infections. While the community of others who are also dealing with it believed that given certain examples, and there were certain examples which everybody knew about, a restaurant in Guangzhou, a particular choir practice which was done by musicians, all of it would have indicated that this is not factually true. But nevertheless, old beliefs take a long time to go. And unfortunately, in this particular case, that's what seems to have been the confusion. And only after it was traced why this is wrong, it was traced to the original articles and researches done 60 years back, that finally this issue was put to bed very reluctantly, and it took much longer than it should have by both CDC and WHO. It took a year, which is very, very surprising, because all measures that we started taking would have indicated that these facts that were being talked about by both CDC and WHO are not correct. And it also had an impact initially on masking, that how effective the masks are. You'll remember, there's a lot of controversy. Masks are not effective because the virus is a very small particle and it can go through most masks. But the point was that the virus doesn't travel as an individual particle. It's generally in a coating of liquid mucus and other stuff. And therefore, it is carried in a much larger particle. And that is caught by the masks, even the cloth masks that we started using. So this wisdom took a much longer time to be accepted within CDC and WHO, particularly the health groups which were concerned about it and who were actually doing this, passing most of these regulations and directives of what should not be done. So it is also a gap that we as a technical, scientific, medical community tend to have, that we use the same words, but we don't go into the basis of what these words really mean for each of the communities. So you get basically a cognitive gap because you're saying apparently the same thing, but actually you are not.
So Prabir, now that we know that airborne transmission is happening and it's finally been accepted by WHO, CDC and all these leading bodies, so now that we're opening up again, if you look at the situation in India, the lockdowns are getting sort of easing down now. What are the sort of precautions that need to be taken by the people? Can we go back to normal, or what sort of changes do you think will have to be made?
So now that we know aerosol transmission takes place, and it should also put to bed the whole controversy about mask or not to mask. Though In India, it was never a very strong controversy. This is much more than the US phenomenon, where people felt asking me to put on masks is an infringement of my fundamental right to infect others. So that was never an Indian in large parts of the world, this was never the issue. But the question is that you cannot go back to normal. If we go back to normal, of course, you have to accept the fact that again, infections will start to grow. And infections obviously have not gone away. If you look at different parts of India at the moment, we are still at middle or tail end of the third wave. Some places, numbers are still going up. But even when numbers are falling, and if we accept that we don't catch all the infections, probably the actual infections could be anything from 3 to 10 times. These are the figures people are saying, these are not my figures. So even if we take that the figures of actual infections are much larger, partly because asymptomatic cases, and partly because mild infections, et cetera, people may not actually go and get themselves tested. So given that there is going to be a risk of infections and the numbers growing again, so how do you prevent that? So obviously you have to now impose rules of different kinds. And it is clear from the recommendations itself that if you are in a place where the air is being diluted continuously, then your chances of infections are less. Therefore, closed spaces are the problems. So certain kind of activities, therefore, are going to be difficult unless the numbers really come down, which is where you have, per se, closed spaces, which is, of course, the cinema halls, large congregations gathering in, say, temples, churches, and mosques. Those are the places you do have large numbers gathering in close proximity, and there would be then possibilities of infection from there. You also have the gyms and indoor dining. Even these are going to be problems. So if you want to open up, you will have to open up in a way, taking this into account and phase-wise opening of the places. Last being when the numbers are really low, only then going to enclosed spaces. So that is one thing that we have to take into account. The need for masks, that you have to still continue to use masks. You have to mask up for others, others have to mask up for you. Even when you sit at home, if guests come, you have to keep your doors and windows open. So those are minimum precautions we'll need to continue taking. So that is one part of it. And the second part of it, and this is a much more long-term problem, is how do engineer buildings, indoor spaces itself? And I think that's a much larger question we also need to address.
Yeah, exactly. So what are the sort of changes that in the future we'll have to look into making into our spaces, such as indoor spaces, like workspaces, offices? You know, what are the changes, particularly in terms of the ventilation, that we'll have to look into making?
Well, I think this is a very important landmark in our lives that we have also understood. For example, the flu infections that takes place every year. Now, why does it take place, for instance, in India in the monsoon seasons? And why does it take place in winters, for instance, in Europe and America? And I think the answer is now very clear, because these are the periods when people stay indoors much more, and therefore they infect each other. In monsoons, we don't go out that much. We are much more indoors, and therefore the infections spread more readily. And of course, this is what happens also in the United States, for example, North America, or in Europe. Now, it's also interesting, this time the flu has been much less. In fact, the number of flu cases, which also show up as pneumonia cases and lead to death for older people, that has been much less this time, for the same reasons that we are talking about. The fact that a social physical distancing has been imposed, places where we are indoors has been, where large numbers of people can meet, has been stopped. So I think this will also have a lot of implications for all infectious diseases which are airborne. So I think this has laid, or put at least in front of us, the key issue that how do you engineer particularly the workspaces? Because that's where you do meet people and much more. And if there is one person who comes to office, who's infected, of course, the number of people will get infected is the consequence. So one is the fact that you need to have far better ventilation in these spaces. So we have been doing our air conditioning based on the fact the exchange of air, fresh air, is kept to a minimum because that reduces our energy costs. I think what we also now recognize, our energy costs will increase because our air conditioning needs a lot of exchange of fresh air. And also it should also give a continuous flow of air inside the buildings. So that has to be carefully engineered, how airflows do take place, and also filters, because even within the offices, you can use what are called HEPA filters, and they filter out a lot of the vaccine virus load that is there in the air. This is also one of the problems people didn't understand how HEPA filters work and how they can actually take out virus particles from the air, even though it may not appear that the mesh that it uses, the filters uses, is much larger than the size of the virus. So how does it filter it out? That's because people don't really understand the mechanics of the HEPA filter. But as we now know, HEPA filter can take a very significant part of the virus load out of there. So in any of the indoor spaces of this kind, we need to also use HEPA filters to continuously filter out the air. It's all of it is going to add to expenses. Therefore, there is going to be much larger expenses for air conditioning, ventilation. We need to redesign all this where a large number of people gather. And that means also the eating places. It also means the gyms, for example. It also means, of course, the cinema halls, mosques, whatever we are talking about, churches, etc. Though they're much larger spaces, so doing it there is not going to be that simple. But it is also possible to provide ventilation, much better ventilation and flow without air conditioning as well. So you could have different levels at which you address these issues, but they need to become a part of our public health issue and how we engineer the indoor spaces. As far as houses are concerned in India, we have to accept that there are a huge number of people who stay in places which are going to be very poor in terms of ventilation. And therefore, the only solution is to provide, of course, at the moment, at least that there should be windows. Windows and doors need to be kept open. But again, at night, that's not possible. So these are limited things that can be done. But it also brings up the issue of housing itself, that we need to consider housing for the people as a fundamental right. And that needs to come back to our agenda. And when it does, then of course, what is the kind of housing we need? That all those should be put. But even in the middle class areas, when we build houses, our attempt is to make or maximize the room space and not consider ventilation and light as a very important part of what we should build. So all those things will have to be baked into the rules itself of how buildings and all the spaces are constructed. So we need to take a very careful look at all the standards that we have built for all of these issues.
So thank you, Prabir, for joining us today. And that's all the time we have. Keep watching NewsClick. Thank you.